like to start by first thanking the TIFR Alumni Association and TIFR for inviting me. It's indeed an honor, and special thanks because asking not to talk about my work, I have to talk about the world's best research that has been done. We have a little bit of interest because of the model system and the technologies that are used. So, what I'm going to tell you about how generally the living systems count time and change their behavior accordingly, and how this whole story has developed, centered around flies and then expanded to other organisms. So, as I mentioned, the living systems adapt to many environmental conditions, otherwise they will be extinct. And at any given location, profound changes in environmental light and temperature occurs daily as a consequence of the rotation of the earth. So if it's light here now, after 12 hours, it will be very dark. And it is hot now, so it will be cold. So the creatures staying in this part have to adapt to these regular changes. To adapt to such changes, most organisms have evolved an internal biological clock that anticipates the day-night cycle and helps them optimize their physiology and behavior. So this internally generated daily rhythm is known as circadian. The circadian rhythms are ancient and they are conserved throughout the evolution. Every organism that is tested has this way of counting time. So this year's Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine are awarded to Jeff Hall, Michael Rospes and Michael Young for their discovery of the molecular mechanism that control the circadian rhythm. And the citation says that the circadian oscillators within the individual cells respond differently to entraining signals and control various physiological outputs such as sleep pattern, body temperature, hormone release, blood pressure and metabolism. The seminal discovery by Hall, Rospes and Young have revealed a crucial physiological mechanism explaining circadian adaptation with important implications for human health and disease. Now, we'll go back to the story. So, for centuries, you don't need a scientist to tell that whether it's a plant or animal, they reciprocate to the daylight or temperature variations. Now, the question is whether this is the circadian behavior seen in plants and animals is governed by an endogenous clock or a similar reaction to external stimuli of a circadian nature. So if it is light, it will be this way. If it is dark, it will be the other way. So many years ago, so like this is one observation, the leaves of mimosa plant close at night and open during the day. So if you, in the day it is open, night is closed. So centuries ago, the French astronomer Jean-Jacques Maron placed a mimosa plant in the darkness, continuous darkness, and he noticed surprisingly that the plant is still following the same rhythm. So it is actually not responding. It has its internal endogenous origin of daily rhythm. So that means it's not reaction near reaction. There is endogenous clock. If this is the case, then the question is, what is the genetic basis of this endogenous circadian rhythm? Right. If it is there is a mechanism, there should be genes who are maintaining it. This was the important question which was asked in 1971 by Konopka and Samuel Benzel using the Drosophila as a model system. What they did was they used flies because flies, this is a life cycle behind in the back somewhere you may not be able to see. So then flies lay eggs, in a day it becomes the first larva, first instar, in a day another stage, then third day another stage, and then few days it pupates, and then flies emerge from this. So this stage is called pupal occlusion. So from the pupa, you will a fly will emerge. And what is known is that there is a particular time of the day, which is early morning, when the pupa will occlude. So Konopka and Benzel did an experiment in which they took the flies, fed them a chemical which creates damage to the DNA in a proper dose, that each fly has probably one or maybe two such changes in the DNA sequence, which we call mutation, and they collected thousands of such mutations, established the independent lines of those mutations, and then went to measure whether they are following this pupil occlusion rhythm or not. So here is the experiment. When you have normal fly, so these are the days, 1, 2, 3, 4 days, and they are counting per hour how many flies are emerging. So you can see there is a pattern emerging. There is a peak in the beginning of the day, then the second day, third day, fourth day, and so on. They found some flies which are following no pattern. So these become arrhythmic. So they, whatever time you take, certain number of flies will emerge, there is no pattern in them. They also find another group of mutants where they are short period. So you see the 4 cycle is completed in 4 days. Here 4 cycles are completed in almost 3 days. So that means they are cycling faster. They also find mutations where the cycles is slower, the period is longer. So even around 4 days, there are only 3 cycles. So what this experiment showed is, the observation is that pupil occlusion rhythm of normal and mutant strains are distinguishable. So you can have a DNA line of fly which behaves differently. So that means the conclusion is that there are genes that are responsible for the circadian behavior, because these are inheritable characters. They also did another assay with these flies, which is called locomotor activity rhythm of individual flies, normal and mutants. So normal fly, if you follow, it will be sleeping and is awake, so it's shown by this activity. This fly is kept in a tube, and with infrared you monitor whether the fly is moving or not moving, and you count it asleep or active. So you can see that there is 24-hour cycle, this activity and sleep time. The arrhythmic mutant fly, which you showed that it was occlusing at any given time, is not following any pattern. Resting for some time, then awake, then again resting, awake, resting, awake. So it is arrhythmic here also. Short period flies again have now 19-hour cycle instead of 24-hour cycle. Long period mutants have 28-hour cycle, so they are not doing 24-hour cycles. Why this is important is that pupil occlusion is once in a lifetime event, while locomotor activity is a lifelong event, every day fly has to do it. So this observation showed that the mutants alter a central clock which has multiple behavioral consequences. So these are extremely important and really path-breaking observation in this field. So after the, so then they use flies because it offers many advantages. So you could easily locate the mutation site on the chromosome, and even techniques that are exclusive for the Drosophila, they mapped that all the 3 mutants that disrupted the circadian within the flies mapped to the same locus on the X chromosome, and they were named period or per. So that means in the same gene, which is having different phenotype, and they made prediction that maybe the molecule will be long with those genes, and that those predictions turned out to be true. What I'm going to do is to keep things simple, so and use less and less of jargons or technicals. After this important experiment, Samuel Benjamin moved on to do something else, while Ron Konopka got a job because of this wonderful work in the Caltech, and he continued working on circadian rhythm. And he did an experiment which is an extremely amazing experiment. So what is done is, now you remember this is the arrhythmic fly per zero, where there is no particular rhythm, it's a fly is awake or asleep, is in continuous manner. And this is the short period fly, which is active for some time, then there is a inactive sleeping, then again active and sleeping. So what Konopka did was, he took a fly which is per O, and then took another fly per S, took out the brain from this fly and planted in the abdomen of the per O. So here is the fly. So per S, brain is taken out from the head and implanted in the abdomen of the per O. Now you can see that it's the same mutant fly, but now there's a brain which is incubated, implanted in the abdomen, and now you can see the cycle is back, rhythmicity is back. When you do the same experiment, but instead of per S brain, you put per zero brain in per zero fly, nothing happens. With this amazing experiment, what it tells is that this is the demonstration of a humoral component of the control of Drosophila activity rhythms. So brain isolated from the short period mutant can produce its characteristic activity rhythm when implanted into abdomen of a genetically arrhythmic host. So the conferred rhythmicity must be due to a diffusible humoral factor secreted from the donor brain. So this is a fantastic thing. So the, it's not the, that each cell has to have the cycle is being controlled by the brain. Now, these two things really brought the momentum to the field. So the basic thing, then major question emerged was that, then what is the molecular basis of the circadian rhythm? So to answer this question, so Jeff Hall and Mike Rosbass, this Hall and Rosbass lab, they were working in Brandeis, and they studied the period gene, they cloned the period gene and showed that the product of this gene builds up in the cell overnight before being broken down during the daytime. So this meant that levels of PERB rose and fell over a 24-hour cycle. So the gene which is mutated when it is, and the fly loses the timekeeping, is actually the product, its product is cycling in a 24-hour cycle manner. And this is the paper which they published in 83, 84. And this paper is essentially what I said. They cloned the period gene and analyzed this product, the per RNA. As you can see, in the dark cycle, there is no per RNA. In the light cycle, there is a per RNA. And when you do at time points, then you see that compared to any controls, the per product peaks up and then goes down, then it peaks and goes down. And this shows, therefore, that per is a clock gene. So this was a major advance. Now it gives you access to understanding how in the cell this process is happening. In around the same time, Michael Young's lab did another very important experiment at Rockefeller University. What they did was, they took a 7,000 nucleotide stretch which covers the period gene, which was presumed period gene, which is cloned by the other group, and they made a transgenic fly which is mutant for per zero, so it has an arrhythmicity in its behavior. And now they brought the, in this background, a 7,000 nucleotide fragment which corresponds to the period gene. So if something is missing, you are providing externally, it should compensate, and that's exactly what it is. So this is the wild type, normal fly, this is the mutant, and when this mutant, you add the 7 kb DNA, now you see the rhythmicity is back. So this result established, therefore, per is the clock gene. Now, so these studies established the molecular basis, and this is the locomotion assay. See, this is the per, and then you make the transgene, it rescues the phenotype completely. So these results showed that how the organism is counting a 24-hour cycle. So the per mRNA and per protein, they both, lots of studies have gone to come up these conclusions that per protein is required for cycling of its own mRNA. So what is happening at the cellular level is that this is, assume this is the period gene, this is transcribed, and this RNA goes to the cytoplasm where the per protein is made. This protein finds a partner called timeless, and they join together and go back to the nucleus and switch off this gene. So once it is switched off, then of course, when there is no more protein, nothing goes inside, then again it will start. So you can see there is a negative feedback loop operating, which gives you some idea of how this chain is cycling in a certain manner. So then of course, when the stage is set, large number of genetic screens were done, and many additional clock genes were discovered. Like clock, cycle, timeless, shaggy, doesn't matter the names, but you can see that what it reflects is that the situation is quite complex. So there is not only per, there is a team, and there is many other factors in that. So the way it is working is from the work of Young, Rosbass and Hall, the mechanism that came up is the translation transcription feedback loop model. So in this, say the period RNA is transcribed, it goes out, and if it associates with the protein called double time, then it will get phosphorylated, will be degraded. If it is not so, or it is protected by interaction through spineless, then this will come and they will go to nucleus and they repress it. So now you can see there is a transcription and there is a translation factor involved in this, so that the cycle is very tightly controlled. So for example, in the morning, time is degraded, which leaves period vulnerable to binding with the double time, get phosphorylated and degraded. So like this, this cycle will continuously operate on 24-hour manner. Now, as everything else, life is complicated, so are the feedback loops, and we are not interested in analyzing these loops, but only thing to show you that is not only these two, three things, there are many more factors, but now we understand the basic, the major components of the mechanism. But now I want to talk, next is the circadian clock in other organisms. As I mentioned to you, that all the organisms have a rhythmic pattern in their behavior. So transcription, translation, feedback loop mechanism are also underlying principle of circadian clock in other multicellular organisms, including humans. So their homologs are found, you can mutate and you can see the phenotypes in appropriate model organisms. And several homologs of the core clock protein in Drosophila, including clock and period, play similar roles in mammalian circadian timekeeping. So this is, in a retrospect, is expected, but it is amazing that this basic timekeeping process evolved very early in the evolution, and that has been preserved or conserved, and has been, which will not go into those detail, more fineness has been added to this during the process of evolution, because this is the basis on which rest of the behavioral patterns are being are evolving. So just a picture to show that in mammals, this, if you, some of you can see, this is period, this is cry, this is CK1, the same kind of feedback loop and all operating. Right? So we have a negative feedback repressor complex, same as you have seen in the slide, the same thing operating in the mammals. We're not going to that. I will tell you something interesting related to timekeeping, which helps us understanding the system much better. And this is the discovery from Unisibular's lab in University of Geneva. I was in the same place for many years, and I've heard this story from him. That even the cells which are growing outside the organism in an incubator, in a plate, they also have circadian rhythm. How this was discovered is very interesting and very useful for the students and even for the PIs. So in Sibler's lab, they are working on transcriptor fraction from the rat liver and studying the regulation of genes and transcription and so on. So a Canadian postdoc identified a very powerful regulator, and they published that in the journal Cell. Now, after a few months, a Swiss student came and took over the project, and then he came back with the news that it's all fake, it doesn't exist. When he performed the isolation, the transcription factor failed to appear, and so they have to retract the paper. So he got worried, so he did himself the experiment. He tried and he found very easily that the transcription factor is coming. So then what is happening, that is one person is not getting, other person is getting. So when they sat down and discussed, it turns out that the postdoc was a late riser. He used to come to lab 11 a.m. and kill the rat and find the transcription factor by the afternoon. But the student was a farmer's son. He would get up at 5 a.m., milk the cows, and reach the lab 7 o'clock and kill the rat. At that time, protein is not there. So this was the way circadian rhythm in the cells was discovered. So what is the take-home message in this? Take-home message, or the moral of the story, is that the apparently failed experiments, if they are done well, they can tell even more than successful experiments, because successful experiments predict what will come. So after that, his lab went on to do this kinds of analysis for large number of transcription factors, and they showed that many of them actually have an expression pattern which shows a circadian rhythm of 24 hours. So these are the products of those genes. They are, and this is the time, you can see they are going down, they are coming up, going down, coming up, and so on, and here is the plot. Right? And there are some, of course, they don't oscillate in this manner. So this then shows that nearly every cell in every tissue in the body gives time. It's not only just the system. So now imagine that every 24 hours, responding to some biochemical call, a handful of proteins assemble in the cell's nucleus. When they bind with each other on certain places in the genome, they become a very strong team, very high impact team. Under their influence, then thousands of genes are triggered. And this trigger then gears the cell jolt, gears the gear of the cell jolts into the motion, the tissue become alive, and on the level of organism, you open your eyes and feel little hungry for the breakfast. So that's the morning. So this is how we are being controlled by our internal clocks because of the inbuilt system that we know when it's the morning, we are not following the light actually so much. Yeah? So by some estimates, now it is estimated that about 40% of our genes in the body follow this rhythmic expression pattern. And of course there are very few cells which lack this clock. But they include biologically compelling examples like they are embryonic stem cells or they are cancer cells. So you can immediately imagine that what the clocks mean and their absence or their lack of functioning indicates something else. So now we go to really the management of behavior with respect to the 24-hour cycle. How does it work? So there is a circadian system in mammals that is composed of a hierarchy of oscillators that function at a cellular, tissue and organism level. So what I am saying is that, first we will describe this. So entrainment and synchronization of the biological clocks in the body takes place in the following manner. So I am summarizing a large amount of work. So there is a group of cells, there are about 20,000 neurons, that are called the suprachiasmatic nucleus or SCN. They are located here and this is a very robust oscillatory network. The SCN is the master clock that governs the peripheral tissue rhythms. And there are experiments done where period product from the rat is rhythmic expression is required for in several tissues for the 24-hour cycle. So which is indicates that the humoral factors or the signals emanating from here are needed for the to coordinate the rhythm of the whole body. So what it means in a simplified manner that SCN gives a signal to the organs and then organs then consisting of large number of cells and this is how the synchronized clock takes place. So the SCN sitting in the brain will tell the pancreas, the liver, muscle, everybody how their cycle should be regulated. So then what we are saying is that 50 trillion little clocks in our body are constantly working under the control of 20,000 cells in the brain telling us how we have to respond and function. So the trillions of clocks working in effectively synchronized manner in our body. It's amazing as if we are some kind of a huge collection of clocks working in a such a efficient manner. Right? So I will not go into the details, but the plants also do the same things. So they take the cues from the light, temperature, process in their center oscillator and give an output of when they should flower, what time hormones should be released, the growth pattern, various kind of metabolism, biotic stress and so on. So environmental signals are integrated by the central oscillator to coordinate the multiple physiological processes. Yes? And the plant is very beautifully studied, the large number of such examples. Now we will discuss a little bit about circadian biology and human health. You may have already started guessing there are so many connections in this. So we will just highlight few of them. So just to put in perspective, the organization of biological activities into precise daily cycle is a nearly universal feature present in all life forms. There is a bacteria, there is fungi, the plant or animals. So circadian rhythm is a physiological and behavioral cycle with a periodicity of 24 hours. It is generated by the endogenous biological clock, the SCN. In synchrony with the solar time, the circadian system dictates 24-hour rhythmicity in number of biological processes in the organisms. Any disruption in this if this is so important, then any disruption in this can therefore affect health and performance. And large amount of work has been done that the circadian clock has an impact on many aspects of our physiology. So this is convergence of thousands of studies, how our body does different ways, different things. So let's say we are somewhere here. So now all of us are in at the best of our coordination. We have the fastest reaction time around this time, and we'll have a great cardiovascular efficiency and muscle strength. That's not required at this moment, but this is how we are at this stage in time. Then after some time, your blood pressure will go up, temperature will rise a little bit, melatonin will start secreting, and then you'll feel sleepy, and then by post midnight, you are in deep sleep around 2 o'clock. Right? Then the body temperature lowers, blood pressure increases, melatonin secretion stops, and you become in a high, the highest alertness state. That's the time to go to school. Right? So this is how we are designed to synchronize our activity with the natural cycle. We have to live in nature. We are not living in air-conditioned room. I mean, we are living maybe past a century or so or few decades, but we have lived thousands and thousands of years in this kind of environment and adjusted to the nature, and these things have been evolved and they are built in for any organism for that matter. So this clock helps. So when I say the clock, I told you in the brain, in the tissue, in the cell, this entire system regulates the sleep pattern, feeding behavior, hormone release, blood pressure, body temperature, and so on, right, as is indicated here. So any disruption in the system can negatively affect sleep quality, alertness, cognitive performance, motor control, mental health, and metabolism. These are all now getting established as a very active area of research now, because we understand that how well controlled the body is. So in next few slides, I will give you some more examples of this kind. So it is emerging that chronic misalignment between our lifestyle and the rhythm dictated by our endogenous circadian clock may be associated with increased risk for various diseases, including cancer, inflammation, metabolic disorders, and neurodegenerative diseases, if we are not keeping proper time. It's highly desirable, therefore, to develop approaches in chronobiology and pharmacology, which is understanding the timekeeping process of the body, and this is the science of how much drug and what time to be given. To modify the period, phase, or amplitude of the circadian clock to improve the human health. And in parallel, of course, administer drugs as per the clock indications, because body is receptive to different things at a different rate depending upon the time. So how syncing drug delivery with our biological clocks could improve the treatments? So I'll give you two examples. Okay, in next slide there are two examples. Here is the background for this, that how does it work. So during the day, our body produces proteins and enzymes required for physical activity, because at that time you are active, digestion, mental activity. At the night, none of these things are required. So when we sleep, our body focuses on other essential pursuits like upkeep of the immune system, memory storage, and so on. So like those, now physical activity is not there. So practically all processes in the body, including how we absorb, metabolize, and then excrete drugs, are orchestrated by the circadian clock. So we can use this knowledge of rhythmic processes to boost the effectiveness of the drug or to minimize its potential side effects. So expression pattern of targets on which the drug is working, because for most of the drugs we know what are the targets, can be matched with the drug administration for better effects. So here are two examples. It has been known for some time that statin, many people take statin. So if the patient takes statin during the night, it has a better effect and less side effects. That is because statin functions via an enzyme called HDHO reductase, and this enzyme is more produced in larger dose in the night. That is when the body is making cholesterol, And that's why if at that time you are giving statin, it will be more effective. If you give it during the daytime, it will be less effective, and therefore it will be going and doing something else which will be side effect. Similarly, delivering chemotherapies to account for the natural oxidation of the drug target is a good idea. Instead of giving to patient constant infusion designed to keep the drug levels stable. In one study at least, the scientists have doubled the survival rate after 5 years for male patients with advanced metastatic colorectal cancer by dosing according to when the drug was expressed. And it's not isolated examples. Now, at least in the model systems, couple of years back, study in mice shows that conserved mammalian genes that are targeted by 56 out of the 100 top best-selling drugs in US show periodic expression. So, which means these 60% of drugs should be given when their targets are in a higher amount. And if you give another time, there will be no benefit of this, only side effects will come. So you can imagine the potential of this. So that was about the drug. So now next couple of slides, I will show you something a little different and a little lighter. So Michael Rasbass published very recently a paper in which he's showing that the fly sleep is affected by the age in a manner similar to that of humans and other mammals, which is that not only do older flies have more fragmented sleep and reduced total sleep time compared to the young flies, the older flies also fail to recover as much sleep after sleep deprivation. So now because they have the experiment, the system, now if you do the same thing with young flies with one result, older flies with different kinds of results. So older flies also show decreased arousal threshold. So these are very interesting observations. We know that the entire system is functionally conserved in all the way up to humans. So what is the next formula? Once you have this observation, using fly, what can you do? Now you can take a chemical or genetic or herbal or whatever you have, a screen to isolate factors that reverse this aging associated disorders. Some fly is having disorder in sleeping. Now feed it different kinds of drugs, different kinds of nutrients, micronutrients, and maybe some of them will improve. If that happens, so you have to look for, make older flies perform better. If flies have given us so much of knowledge, then we understand that this also can be expected. Now since most of these mechanisms conserved all the way up to humans, so I don't know, you can also expect that these things can help us a lot in that, which is not when they're taken as disease, but they can help us in managing the life, particularly at later stages, much better. Right? So now I will close by two more slides, which is something for us to think about from all of this. What we have learned, that we have very robust clock system, which is originated and evolved, keeping in context the movement of the rotation of the earth, which is change in the time, change in the temperature, light. When we are disturbing that, so here is a statement by a very well-known neuroscientist: a catastrophic lack of sleep in modern society is killing us. Lighting, television, computer screens, smartphones, longer commutes, the blurry of the line between work and personal life, and a host of other aspects of modern life are contributing to sleep deprivation. So you can imagine that something we may not notice, but it may be doing something not what we want. You see, this is the view of our planet from the space. So actually this is the night view, so everything should be either dark ocean or dark blue, but you see a lot of disturbances. They look beautiful maybe, but they are disturbances. Look at our country. There's a lot of it, there is no light, that means. So what happened to life that has for millions of years that evolved to follow day, night, now suddenly they are all confused. Just maybe it's not a bad degree, but are we missing something by distorting the circadian rhythm, the light-dark cycle that has been a key baseline for evolutionary process? will our ability to adapt can take care of such disturbances? We don't know. So we need to figure that out. Till we figure it out, let there be a day, let there be a night, let there be dark, let there be light, and let our clock get clear inputs so that we can manage the body's, so that it can manage body's function. In other words, we should try to follow what we are evolved and not stress our system too much. So, thank you very much for your attention and your.